are going to start right now. So the next session is, so Guillaume Burel is going to talk about translating tools from automated theorem tables.
Okay, thank you. So I'm going to present you links between deductive lambda pi and automated theorem proving. So, but first, some thought about proof assistance and automated theorem prover. So it is well known that one of the limitations of proof assistance is their lack of automation. So there has been a lot of improvements in the recent years, but still there is still an issue. And this lack of automation makes that it is quite hard to master such tools, and you need to be an expert to be able to use them, and it hinders the use of such tools in the industry. On the other hand, you have automated theorem provers, which are push-button tools, but the problem is that we don't know if we can trust them. In fact, they are quite complex piece of software, and they are highly optimized. So there is some prover, I don't remember its name, but it is coded in C or C++, and they use pointers, of course, and they use some of the bits of the pointers that are not useful for the pointers to store extra information to reduce the memory consumption of the solver. So let's say you cannot certify such a tool, you will not be able to be sure that it works correctly. So we would like to have the best of both worlds. And to do that, we want to add some cooperation between proof assistance and automated theorem provers. So for instance, in proof assistance, now you can discharge some proof obligation to automated theorem provers. For instance, in Isabel, you have the sledgehammer tactic, which calls other automated theorem provers to find a proof, and then the proof is reconstructed in Isabel. You have also the SMT Coq plugin for Coq, and there are also other works in the same vein. On the other hand, for automated theorem provers, if we want to increase the confidence in them, what we can do is to make them produce proofs that can be independently checked. And the best will be if such proofs are in a format checkable by the proof assistant that you use every day. Since this is the deductive school, I will speak a bit about deductive. We want to use deductive as a pivot for proof interoperability. And so all the export from and to automated theorem provers should, in theory at least, pass by deductive. And so in an ideal world, what we would like to have is to be in deductive, or more precisely, in lambda pi, because we are searching for a proof interactively. And we have some proof obligations that we want to discharge to an automated theorem prover. First, the logic of the automated theorem prover is not the logic of lambda pi. It's not the lambda pi calculus modulo theory. So we need some encoding of the goals that we want, some translation into a formula that can be accepted by the automated theorem prover. Then we call the automated theorem prover. It outputs some proof, some kind of proof. But this proof, it is not necessarily in the format of lambda pi, and also it's not of the original formula, but of the encoded formula. So we need to reconstruct the proof to be able to incorporate it in lambda pi. So in this presentation, I will present the two directions, so from lambda pi to the automated theorem prover, and back from the automated theorem prover to lambda pi. So let's start from LambdaPy to the automated theorem prover. To do that, we can rely on a tool which is called Y3, which is a platform for deductive program verification. And in Y3, you can write some programs and some specification. And then, to prove this obligation, Y3 is able to delegate the proofs to many provers. So it has drivers that translate the proof to the input format of various provers. And so it's a good starting point if you want to call external automated theorem provers. And using this tool, there has been a tactic that has been added to LambdaPy, which is called Y3, and which it works the following way. So you start from LambdaPy with some goal to prove. Then you will abstract this goal because your automated theorem prover will not accept the whole language of LambdaPy. So you will do some abstraction to obtain a first order formula. Actually, now it's only a propositional formula, but it's a question of implementation. We know how to do first order logic in the world. Then we can call Y3 on this formula to delegate the proof on various provers, so such as Vampire, AlterGo, or CVC4. And then this prover answers that they have found a proof or not. If they have found a proof, what we can do, at least now, is that we will admit the goal as an axiom, and we will trust the result of the prover. Of course, it is not satisfactory, but it is what is done for the moment. So let me show you a brief demo of that. So I place myself in first order logic. So this is the theory presented by Gilles yesterday. So we use a set prop on the quantifiers. Now we need to tell the tactic Y3 is not it is generic. It does not depend on a particular theory, but you have to say how first order logic is represented in the theory that you want. So for that, you use what is called built-ins, and you say that the false formula will be represented by this symbol, etc., etc. And then you can try to do proofs. So let's try to prove that A and B in place A. Okay. So we have A and B, we want to prove A and B implies A. So what we can do is just to call Y3 to delegate the proof to some provers. And so we can call Y3 on CVC4. And here it works. And in fact, CVC4 says that there is a proof of such a formula. And so we admit the formula and we can end the proof. We can do something more. I said that the formula is abstracted as a propositional formula, but we can still do formulas that are first order formula. So for instance, we can prove that for all x, y, q of x and q of y implies q of x. So this is the same. Here I call Y3, so if I don't precise the prover, it's AlterGo, which is called by default, but it works. Okay. AlterGo. Because it's the same team that does Y3 and AlterGo. So. But we can... Yes?
Why do we have to assume X and Y? Why do we have to do this first step by hand?
It's because, at least now, how it is done is you have to have a goal of the form proof of something to pass it to the provers. But in theory, it is not useful because we could have this is convertible to for all x for all y q of x, proof of for all x for all y q of x q and q of y implies q of x. And so in theory we could find a proof also for the whole formula, but it just as it was not implemented that way for now on. So it's just a small plugin. There was not a lot of work done on that, so. But it can help a little bit. You can also have higher order stuff that goes in the way. So for instance, this is you can have an higher order predicate that takes a function and return an element. You can have a symbol that takes a proposition and returns an element. And even if you have such a high order predicate, you can use this tactic to prove goals, because you will abstract all the subterms that are not in propositional logic. So for instance, you can prove that if you have proper LXX and Q of select bottom, then you have proper of LYY, because of course it's A and B in price A. So, okay. And to do that, you can call Y3, and it will replace all the subterms that are not propositional logic by fresh atoms. But if you have two subterms that are equals modulo alpha renaming, it will replace them by the same atom. So it will call Y3 on the formula A and B implies A. So that's why it works. But it is not complete. As I say, we only deal with propositional logic and not first order logic yet. And for instance, we are not able to prove that for all x, q of x implies q of a for some a. If we try to do that and we call y3, it says that AlterGo did not find a proof. We can try other provers, it will not find a proof because this is abstracted as A implies B. So we don't know how to prove that. But of course, there is a proof and we can do it by hand. It's quite easy in that case. Okay, so it's a work in progress at least, but it can help a little bit.
Can I have a question?
Yes.
In principle, Vampire should solve first order formulas. Right?
Yes.
Yeah. Why can't I just export that one to
It's just that, for now on, the formula is abstracted as a propositional formula. And you pass to Vampire or anything, A implies B. And of course, it cannot prove A implies B. But we know, at least theoretically, how to pass this formula to Vampire. It's just that it has not been implemented yet. Then there will be another question: is if you want to encode higher order logic into first order logic to pass them to first order provers, but it's not the case yet. We want to stick to what can really be done. Okay, so that was for the first part. So from Lambda Pi to the automated theorem provers. Now we look at the other direction. So we have automated theorem provers, and we want them to be able to produce DDT or Lambda Pi proofs. As I said, it's hard to trust automated theorem prover because they are quite big piece of software with a complex proof calculi. And they are finely tuned with optimization hacks. Originally, such provers only answered yes or no, and more often maybe, because of course they are not complete. But more and more, they produce at least proof traces. That is, they say the big steps that were performed to obtain a proof. If you want to increase the confidence in such automated theorem provers, we can either build a proof checker for the output of such provers. So they produce proof traces. We can build a dedicated proof checker to check such traces. And if we certify this proof checker, we will have the guarantee that the proofs are valid. This is what is done, for instance, for SAT solvers. So SAT solvers are producing proofs in a format that is called a D-rate, which is essentially a list of clauses that are generated. And there has been a proof checker for such a format that has been written in Coq and extracted. And so this checker can certify that the D-rate traces are correct. There is another approach, which is to directly produce a proof that can be checked by your favorite assistant, to directly produce a Coq proof or an Isabel proof, or in our case, a deductive proof. And this is the approach that I will present here. To do that, a first idea would be to instrument the prover to make it able to produce a proof. So you have your problem, you have your automated theorem prover, and you change the code so that it is able to produce a deductive proof at the end. So this approach has an advantage, which is that you have access to all the information that you need to construct the proof. You know which inference rule was used on which formula, at which position, etc., etc. You have all that you need. However, there are some drawbacks. The first one is that you need to embed the whole proof calculus of the prover into deductive, and this proof calculus can be quite large, and also it's not necessarily stable, because every year there are new versions of automated theorem provers that are changing the inference rules used by the prover. And also, some of the drawbacks is that you need to know precisely how the code works, to know where you need to add codes to produce the proofs. And so this approach is more or less easy depending on the complexity of the code and also the complexity of the proof calculus. And of course, it is easier if from the beginning the prover was developed to support a proof output. So this is the case, for instance, for Zenon, which was developed with the idea that it should produce Coq proofs at the beginning. Now it can produce proofs for many other formats too. And so because of that, it's not reasonable to do that for every provers, and it can only be done for a few provers. But it has been done for at least three of them. So these are three provers that can output deductive proofs. So there is iProver Modulo, which is an extension of the prover iProver. Zenon Modulo, which is an extension of the prover Zenon. And ArcSact, which is an SMT solver. And all three of them are able to produce deductive and or lambda pi proofs. To do that, to do proofs, first you have to carefully choose in which theory you are working. In general, it will be an encoding of first-order logic in deductive. But For instance, for Zenon modulo, you have a bit more than first order logic because you have types and you have ML polymorphism. Okay, and then you have two approaches to translate your proofs. Either you build proofs, you translate your proofs directly into this encoding, or you embed your proof calculus into deductive. And I will present the two approaches and show you why the second one is probably better. Show you that, I will present you how it is done in iProver modulo. So as I said, iProver modulo is a patch to iProver, which is itself a combination of a proof method that is called instantiation generation and combined with ordered resolution. What it is interesting for us is ordered resolution because this is the proofs in ordered resolution that will be translated into deductive. Okay, and proofs in ordered resolution works in the following way. So it uses clauses. So a clause is a set of literals, and literals are either atomic proposition or negation of atomic proposition. And then you have basically you have a set of clauses, and you generate new clauses using the resolution rule, which says that if you have a clause with some literal P and a clause with some literal not Q, and that P and Q are unifiable, then you generate a new clause CD in which you apply the most general unifier of P and Q. And you do that until the empty clause is produced. And if the empty clause is produced, it shows that the initial set of clauses was unsatisfiable. In general, this set of clauses is obtained by the negation of a formula, so it means that the original formula was provable. So the goal here now is to translate this resolution rule into deductive. And to do that, we have to know how to represent clauses. So a clause is a set of literals, but semantically, this corresponds to a universal quantification of disjunction. And to represent them, we can use a standard unpredicative encoding. Just instead of having a binary disjunction, we have a MRE disjunction, which leads to such kind of formulas. But this is exactly the same encoding as what was presented yesterday. And now we can see how the encoding of resolution works. So I will only present it on an example. So suppose that you have two clauses, P and Q and R and not P. So this means that you have a formula C1 whose type is the representation of the clause. So P implies bottom, implies Q, implies bottom, implies bottom. And for R not P, you have a term C2, which has type R implies bottom, implies P implies bottom, implies bottom, implies bottom. And now we want to build a new term, D, which is the resolvent, so QR. And so we need to provide a term which has type Q implies bottom, implies R implies bottom, implies bottom. So to obtain that, we can abstract these and these. And we can use C1 and C2 to obtain the term. So we can use C1. So C1, it waits for a proof of P implies bottom and a proof of Q implies bottom. So we have already a proof of So we have already a proof of Q here, and we have to build a proof of P, P implies bottom. So we take an abstraction of P, and we need to provide a proof of bottom. So here we take the second clause, C2. So we have to provide a proof of R implies bottom and a proof of P implies bottom. We have the proof of R here. And for the proof of P implies bottom, we take an abstraction of P implies bottom. And now we have P, we have P implies bottom, so it's easy to derive bottom. And so we can do that in the general case. And we see how the resolution rule is directly embedded into deductive. This can be extended to various simplification rules and rewritings that occurs in iProver modulo. And at least in theory, it can be extended to superposition, which is a calculus which is used in the prover E and Vampire. But it has some limits. First, it works only if the proof is found using only resolution. So in iProver modulo, that means that we cannot use the instantiation generation part of the prover. And the other big limit is that there is no translation of the transformation of the original formula into clauses. So we have the proof that once you have the clauses to the empty clause, but not of the transformation of the original formula into the clauses. So this is for iProver modulo. Now I will present you how it is done in Zenon modulo. So Zenon modulo is an extension of Zenon. Zenon is a prover based on the tableau method, and it has been extended to handle deduction modulo theory and arithmetic. And also, it is able to deal with polymorphic first-order logic with equality. Let me briefly show you how the proof calculus of Zenon works. So, as usual in automated theorem proving, it consists of proof by contradiction. So, you negate the formula that you want to prove and you derive contradictions. And tableau method, in fact, you can see them at sequence calculus, starting from the bottom, and using meta variables to handle the quantifiers. So for instance, in Zenon, you have these three rules that must be read from top to bottom. Here, this rule is a closure rule. It says that if in your branch you have a formula P and a formula not P, then you can close the branch. And the goal is to close all the branches of the proofs. This rule says that if in your branch you have not A implies P, then you can add in your branch not A and B. So you add the two formulas in your branch. And this rule says that if you have in your branch not A and B, then you can produce two new branches. You can split your branch into two, one in which you add not A and the other one with not B. And so, for instance, if you want to prove P implies P and P, so you take the negation of this formula, so you have not P implies P and P. If you use this rule alpha not implies, you will add two formula into your branch, so you add P and you add not P and P on your branch. I think this is wrong here, this must be A and not B. It would make more sense. So you want to refute that not A implies B, so you have A and not B. Okay. Okay. The rule here is wrong, but the application here is correct. And now you have not P and P. And what you can do is you can apply this rule, and you have two branches. And in both of these branches, you have not P. And now, in both branches, you can close the proof because you have not P and P here, and not P and P, so you can close. You have closed all your branches, so the proof is complete. You're done. Yes.
This is not traditional.
Yes, I understand. It's just that you have branches in which you have formulas, and here it just says that you add these formulas at the end of your branch, and so here maybe I should not have put this horizontal line here because you add from this formula you add. P and not P and P on the branch. Well, maybe it's not the best representation, but it's the one that is traditionally used.
So there are 1, 2, 3, 4 levels of horizontal lines, okay, in the proof tree.
Yes, but.
And the first, the top one and the one below it are not the same kind.
Yes, this one should not have been there. I forgot to remove it. Okay. So now we want to translate set proofs. But we will not do the same as for lambda pi. We will have we will first do a deep embedding of the proof calculus into deducti. By deep embedding, I mean that we will add symbols for each of the inference rules of the proof calculus. So for instance, we have this closure rule here. We'll add a symbol to embed it into deducti. And essentially, this symbol says that if we have a proof of P and a proof of not P, we can have a proof of bottom of the contradiction. Here, for this rule, it says that to obtain a proof that not A implies B leads to a contradiction, we can use a proof that from a proof of A and a proof of not B leads to a contradiction. And so we can embed these inference rules as a symbol. And here it is the same. To obtain a proof that not A and B implies a contradiction, we must find a proof that not A implies a contradiction and that not B implies a contradiction. So if we have a proof that not A implies a contradiction and a proof that not B implies a contradiction, we obtain a proof that not A and B implies a contradiction. And so,
you have to prove one of them?
Here you have to prove both of them because you have to close all the branches.
You have to prove not A and B. Isn't it enough to prove that one of them is absurd?
You want to.
I mean, the Morgan says that it's equivalent
you want to refute
not A or not B.
No, you want to refute not A and B.
Yeah, you're repeating. Another negation.
Yes.
Sorry, too many negations.
Sorry. Yeah. Sometimes it can be confusing. Okay. So now we have a deep embedding of our proofs. And for instance, this example will be translated as this proof term in lambda pi. So this is actually what Zenon modulo will produce. I reduced some eta. I made some eta reduction to make it more readable. But it is the proof term that will be produced. And here we see that we have here this is where the branches are closed. This is where we split into two branches. And this is the topmost rule.
What is P or F component?
PRFC, it is PRF, but for classical logic. So I think Gilles presented it yesterday. But so it just, in fact, it's PRF of that, of the double negation of that. Because of course we are in a classical logic, so we work here. Enfin, Zenon modulo works in classical logic, so we need to have that. Okay, but this is a deep translation, and we are not not happy with that, because if we want to share such proof with other development, we want to have a proof in the first order encoding, first order logic encoding, and not using such a deep encoding. So to do that, we will make the encoding more shallow, but we will make it in two steps. First, we will translate the encoding of Zenon proof calculus into natural deduction, and then we will translate natural deduction into deductive directly, and I will explain why later. So how many of you are familiar with natural deduction? Most of you, I hope. So I will not present you the rules, they are not all there. We can quite easily embed natural deduction in LambdaPy. So for instance, if you have the introduction rule for the conjunction, you have and I symbol, which says that if you have a proof of P and a proof of Q, you have a proof of P and Q, and so on. And you have so symbols for introduction and elimination rules for all the connectives. Now, what we can do is that you can translate the rules of Zenon in terms of natural deduction. So you can rewrite your you can define the symbols corresponding to the rule of Zenon in terms of natural deduction. So for instance, the closure rule of tableau can be expressed in terms of the elimination of the negation. In fact, what you have to prove is that the rules of tableau are derivable in natural deduction, but it is it can be done without problem if you are in natural deduction with an axiom for classical logic, of course. Okay, so this is a first step to go to a shallow embedding. If we do that on the example, what we can show is that our example will be convertible. It can be reduced to such a term, where we can see that the introduction rule and elimination rule for natural deduction appears. For instance, we have the introduction rule for implication here, the introduction rule for the conjunction here. Okay, but it is not enough. We want to go even more shallow. And what we can do to do that is to reduce natural deduction directly into the encoding of first order logic in deductive. And to do that, we can define the symbols of natural deduction in terms of deductive proofs. So for instance, the symbol for the introduction of implication, so I recall its type here. So it takes a proof, it takes a function that takes a proof of P and gives a proof of Q, and it gives a proof of P implies Q. But if you use the encoding of first order logic into deductive, the shallow encoding of first order logic into deductive, you know that proof of P implies Q, it is convertible with proof of P flash arrow, sorry, proof of Q. And so we have the same here and here. And that's why implies the introduction of the implication. In fact, it's just the identity.
Are there dollar signs missing from
readability? I did not put dollar signs because I put everything on the right hand side of the. So it's lambda terms, and on the variables bound by a lambda, you don't have dollar signs. But I could have written that implies I, dollar P, dollar Q, dollar pi, euro, dollar pi. It is the same. Essentially. Okay, if we do that, on our example, what we obtain is a proof of P implies P and P, which is completely at the deductive level with only lambdas and applications. Okay, and so this is a let me just say that this approach is more convenient than the approach in high power modulo because you have first your deep embedding, which is more easy to obtain from the prover, and then you use deductive to rewrite it to a more shallow embedding. Okay, let me carry on. So this is good for some provers. But we cannot expect to instrument every solver or every prover that exists to make them produce deductive proofs. Some of them are quite large pieces of software. Their developers are, in general, not expert in the lambda pi calculus modulo theory, so they will not be able to do the job themselves. And there is also another drawback, which is that the proof calculus of such tools is not stable. It changes every year because developers tries to use new techniques, etc. And they are quite big too. So you have to maintain a huge set of inference rules, which could be cumbersome. So just to give you an example, this is the proof calculus used by E, and it takes four pages of LaTeX. And if you wanted to translate it into deductive, you will have to handle each of these inference rules, and you have to show how that could be embedded into deductive. So this is not reasonable. So instead of that, we'll use another approach. Nowadays, provers produce at least what I call a proof trace, which is the list of formulas that were derived to obtain the proof. And sometimes you have even more information. You can have the premises that were used to obtain the formula. You can have the name of the inference rules, the theory in which this inference rule works, etc., etc. And the idea is that we will use this proof trace to reconstruct a proof into deductive. So let me show you an example of trace format, which is the TSTP format. So it is a format which is used in the CAID community. So it is the Hadoop format of E, of Vampire, of the superposition. And the basic idea is that it is a list of formula that is annotated by a small inference tree which says which lists were used to produce the formula. So to show you the example, here we have a formula which is in closed normal form, which is why we have this CNF keyword here. This is the name of the formula, the label of the formula. Here, this is just the role of the formula. It can be axiom, conjecture. Here, plain, it just means that the formula has no semantics. This is the formula in itself. So it is a formula in first order logic with equality. And here, This is a proof tree which says how the formula was obtained. So it was obtained by using formula C030 and C018, applying the rule SPM, and with the resulting formula, and the formula C030, applying the rule RW to obtain this formula. Okay, so we want to use such information to reconstruct the proof, but we want to stay independent of the proof calculus. We don't want to rely on the precise meaning of the inference rules, because as I said, they are not stable. So we want to have a tool that that works even if the inference rules changes. To do that, we will reconstruct the proof. So we will use the content of the proof trace to reconstruct a deductive proof. And the idea is that each of the line of the proof trace corresponds to some step into a bigger proof. And what we will do is that each line will be converted into a small problem, which says that from the premises we obtain the formula of the step. And then each of these steps will be reproven using a prover that can produce deductive proofs, using, for instance, Zenon modulo. And then you will have small proofs for each of the steps, and you can combine them to get a proof of the original formula. We want to be agnostic with regard to the prover that produces the trace. That's why we don't want to rely on the actual inference rules that are used. And also, we want to be agnostic with regard to the prover that reproves the steps. We don't want to rely on Zenon modulo. We can use any prover that can produce a deductive proof. So this has been implemented by my former PhD student Yassine El Haddad in a tool which is called Extracto. So Extracto, it takes TSTP proof trace as input, and from this proof trace, it will reconstruct a proof for lambda pi. And the general architecture is the following one: you take your problem. You solve it using any ATP that can produce a TSTP trace, so for instance E or Vampire. You get a proof trace, and then you feed this proof trace to Extracto. Extracto will take each line of the proof trace. It will produce a small problem for each of these lines. Then we will call Zenon modulo or any other prover that can produce deductive proofs on each of these steps. And hopefully, Zenon modulo will be able to produce a lambda pi proofs for each of the steps. Then all we have to do is to recombine all the steps together, but it's quite straightforward. Now, concerning the experimental evaluation of these, we took every problem in closed normal form of the TPTP library. So the TPTP library is a quite large set of problems for automated theorem provers. We took only the problems that were already in a closed normal form. I will explain later why. To produce the traces, we used both in E and Vampire to compare how it worked. And to reprove each of the steps, we used Zenon modulo and ArcSat. And the results are the following one. So concerning the small steps, so here we have the percentage of the steps that could be proven either by Zenon modulo or by ArcSat. And so we see that we can prove almost all of them, but not all of them. But of course, if you have only one step that fails, you cannot reconstruct the complete proof. And so if you look at the percentage of proofs that can be actually reconstructed into Lambda Pi, you obtain a lower percentage. But still, this is much better than trying to prove the original formula using either Zenon modulo or ArcSat, because Zenon modulo and ArcSat are not so efficient. And so it is better to use E or Vampire to prove the proofs and then to reconstruct the proof. You will get more proofs than using Zenon modulo or ArcSat directly. Okay, now there are still some problems, some theoretical problems, and not just practical, which is that in the proof traces, some of the steps are not provable, in the sense that their conclusion is not a logical consequence of their premises. It's not a problem for the proof trace, because in fact, we know that the conclusion preserves probability, which means that if you have a proof of the initial set of formula, if and if you have a proof of the set of formula plus the new conclusion. And so because of that, the proof traces are correct. But of course, Extracto will not work on such proof steps, because it will not be able to prove that the conclusion is a consequence of the premises. And so such steps cannot be handled directly by Extracto, and we need to handle them a bit by hand. And it is not some side remark, because almost all of proofs contain such steps. Because, for instance, it is the case of scolemization. So scolemization, it's a way to eliminate the existential quantifier. So if you have a proof of B using an axiom for all x exist y, such as A xy, you can, to prove that, you can search a proof of B, but replacing the axiom by for all x, A of x, f of x, where f is a fresh symbol, which is called a scolem symbol. And so you preserve provability, but the thing is that the what you have at the left does not imply the formula is not a consequence of the right hand side formula is not a logical consequence of the left hand side. And the thing is that this scolemization is present in the CNF transformation, and almost all automated theorem provers use clauses, and so they use CNF transformation to work. So we will have such step into our proof traces. So to handle this, Yassine developed another tool, which he called Scandverto. And here the goal is to take an axiom and its scolemized version, and a Lambda Pi proof, we choose the scolemized version. And if you call Scandverto on such input, it will provide a Lambda Pi proof, but we choose the non-scolemized axiom. So it will transform the proof to make it use the non-scolemized axiom. So how does it work? It is based on a constructive proof of the scolem theorem by Gilles and Benjamin Werner, which was done in the context of first-order natural deduction. And so we implemented this process. But we, when we tried it, we found some problems because the proof of the Skolem theorem, it assumes that the proofs that are fed to the Skolem theorem are in normal form. In normal form for natural deduction, which means that they must be in normal form with regard to so-called commuting cuts. So maybe you're not familiar with a commuting cut, but in natural deduction, you have standard cuts. So just if you have you introduce an implication and then you eliminate it, you can reduce it. So I think you are familiar with that. And if you stay in the fragment where you only use implication, conjunction, and the universal quantification, then then all works well. But if you use disjunction and existential quantification, then you have problems, and you need to add such commuting cuts, which says that if you eliminate a disjunction and then you eliminate, for instance, a conjunction, then you may need to put the elimination of the conjunction above the elimination of the disjunction to obtain a real normal form. The problem is that if we work on shallow proofs, these cuts are no longer visible. They are present in the proofs, but we cannot see them because we don't know how to find them. On the other hand, the regular cuts, they are not there because they are embedded into beta indexes, so they have disappeared. So that's good, but not the commuting cuts. And so to be able to perform the proof, we need to stay at the natural deduction encoding level to be able to add rules such as this one, which says which is the rule for the commutations that I've presented here. And so that's why I presented the translation of Zenon modulo proofs using two levels, one into natural deduction proofs and then into the deductive layer directly. If we stay at the natural deduction level, you can reduce the commuting cut and you can apply the algorithm here to obtain a proof. And so if you close convert to us on such an example where you have a formula here, a step which is Skolemized, so you use this F symbol is a Skolem symbol, you can apply sconverto to obtain a proof using the axiom that is not Skolemized now. And we can see that in the proof, we no longer use the Skolem symbol, which was not the case if we did not reduce commuting cuts. So as a conclusion, I have presented you two ways to obtain deductive proofs from automated theorem provers. The first one is to instrument the provers directly. It's good if you start your prover from scratch and you develop it yourself. But if you want to get proofs from a provers developed by somebody else, which is quite complex, what I suggest to you is to reconstruct proofs. The drawback being that you probably cannot reconstruct all the proofs. As we have seen, we only reconstruct 65% of e-proofs. And it is not only for automated theorem provers, it can also be done for proof assistants. For instance, it is what is intended to be able to have proofs from PVS or from the Atelier B, which is a tool using the method B. We want to instrument these provers just to provide a trace and then reconstruct the trace using such techniques. And to conclude, what remains to be done now is to link everything together, that is to be able to start from deductee or lambda pi, to pass a formula to an automated theorem prover, which will give you a trace. Then you can translate back to deductee using extracto and converter.